Well, Frog here. I'm going to take y'all along with me on a 4-day, 3-night camping trip I'm going to do in the Florida backwoods. I'm going to spend the first 2 nights alone, and then for the last night, my cousins are going to join me. Now, what you're looking at is my wife dropping me off, and as you can see here, I'm going to show you the date and the time. And throughout my trip, I'm going to show you the date and the time as it goes on, so you can see that I am actually going to be out here the full 72 hours. I've got 3 cameras with me. My main camera is going to be my GoPro that I'm going to wear on a body harness. I'm also going to use my iPhone and my Panasonic camcorder. Here are the rules of the game. Safety first. Your biggest threat where I'm camping is other humans. See, here on the road that I'm walking in on is a campfire that somebody left. And you can see some fresh tire marks here in the dirt. See them there just in the bottom there that I'm pointing out. Humans are coming and going always from this area. Now, most of the people that come and go here probably don't mean you any harm. But I know enough about this area to know that there is a lot of crime out here, so I don't want to run into other people. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have to use roads as an access point, but as soon as I can, I'm going to get off the roads. Notice as I'm walking, I'm not walking in the sand, I'm walking in the grass to the side. The reason for that is I don't want to leave any footprints. I don't want anyone to know that I'm walking back here. So number one rule is don't draw attention to yourself. And that's why I'm not talking as I walk. I'm actually doing my commentary after the fact. No talking when you're solo camping. You don't want anyone to hear your voice carry. Your voice will carry in the woods a long ways. So just stay silent. Here where the road is muddy, I'm just taking care to only walk where the grass is growing thick, where I'm not going to leave any tracks. I'm not walking in the mud. I'm trying to stay out of the water as much as I can. Right, you can see some fresh deer tracks down there if you look close enough, but you won't see my tracks. See how I'm stepping over the mud? I'm stepping from one tuft of grass to the other. There, and see them past it. Turn around and look. No tracks. More fresh human sign. Here's another campfire that was left on the road here. See, it's been rained in. Now this habitat I'm in is what we call planted pines. It's pretty common in Florida to have pine forests that are planted by the timber industry. So you notice that the pines are in straight rows here. See, they're all around me here. Now the land is also sloping downward, and that's because I'm actually heading towards a river system. That means you can expect the habitat to start to change as the land slopes down. When you spend enough time in the woods, you learn to read the terrain, not just the topography, but also the vegetation, and you begin to learn about the different breaks in habitat and how one habitat transitions into another. See, here I'm showing you swamp cabbage. Well, what we call swamp cabbage, this is actually the sable palm. And it's very much like another kind of little palm we have called a saw palmetto, but that's actually not a saw palmetto, that's a sable palm coming up. And it's actually edible. That's why we call it swamp cabbage. The heart is edible. And it makes great shelter, or the fronds make good shelter. But this stuff generally grows around water. So when you start seeing a lot of this, it tells you that the land is getting lower and probably a little bit wetter, and the soil is getting a little bit richer. See, over there you got a mixture of cabbage palm and saw palmetto together. We've had recent rains, and I can see some fresh deer tracks here. That's actually a pretty good sized deer track right there. And that's a good sign. The further back in here I'm getting, the less human sign I'm seeing. Now, of course, I'm still on a road, and humans still make their way back here, but I'm starting to see some game sign. See the fresh deer tracks in here? That's good. That means I'm probably walking in the right direction in terms of finding a good place to camp and do some hunting. You see, the deeper down in here I walk, the more the habitat changes. It's still sloping downward. You can see more swamp cabbage growing up. You can see some saw palmetto starting to come up. You can see lots of oak trees and other hardwoods coming up, not as many pines. We call a habitat that is mostly hardwoods, meaning oaks and, you know, elms and cherry trees and those sorts of trees. We call those hammocks in Florida. And I'm coming into a hammock in here the further in here I walk. Now, I'm starting to find a lot of acorns as I walk here. These are fresh acorns from this past fall. We had such a bumper crop of acorns this year that we still have acorns on the ground. The game animals haven't eaten them all yet, but they'll be eating these for the rest of winter. That's a good find. Good for hunting. Habitat is continuing to change deeper into hammock here. So you can see more and more palmettos and swamp cabbage palms are coming up in here. Ground is getting kind of wet, but it's not swampy. It's just good, dark, rich soil. Back in the old days, this was the kind of habitat that settlers in Florida would clear out and make their farms on because the soil is dark and rich, not sandy and poor like it is in most Florida forest habitats like you find in pine flatwoods. At a point now where I'm going to stop and take a break. I've been walking for about maybe 40 minutes now, 40 minutes to an hour. And it's real pretty in here. I just said, that's good. I'm glad, or this is good, because I'm glad to be out here. Real pretty woods. And I'm getting thirsty, so I'm going to get me a drink of water here. Now, I don't carry water in with me because it's very heavy. I always get my water out of the woods. I'll show you in just a second here. This is a puddle of water here in the hammock, and it's actually pretty clean in terms of not having a lot of suspended sediment. It has a little bit of a milky color to it, but there's no actual dirt in it to plug my filter up. I've checked the area really good for snakes before I've laid down, and I'm just drinking straight out of it, and it's cool and refreshing. As I continue to walk, the woods get thicker here, more lush. And I'm off the beaten path now. I'm off any trail or road. And you can see I found some bamboo. A lot of people don't know that bamboo is actually native to Florida. There is a species native here and native to many southern states. Back in the 1800s at the latest, there were millions of acres of pure bamboo forest in the southeast. We called those cane breaks. And generally that habitat is extinct today. Many people don't even realize that parts of the southeast looked a lot like a Chinese mountain bamboo forest. But in fact, that was the case. I'm only aware of one such place today where you can actually see a straight bamboo forest, but you'll still find some of it growing in little patches along wet areas, as I've just found. Here I found a creek that I'm going to follow for a ways, and I'm actually familiar with this creek. I'm not familiar with this particular stretch of woods, but I do know the creek in a different location, and I'm going to look for a spot to camp in here. So let me talk to you about what I'm looking for in a campsite here. I am looking for, first, an area that is near water, which I've got on this creek. I'm looking for an area that's back in the thick so that I can kind of blend in and so that if someone or something was to walk up on me, they'll make a lot of noise. See these fronds in here, these swamp cabbage fronds? Something can't help but walk through them and make some noise, whether it be human or a deer or some other animal. The next thing I'm looking for is to make sure there are no old dead limbs above me that are going to fall on me. The woods are actually kind of windy. You might be able to hear it in some of the video that I'm recording, but the woods are very windy. A front is passing through, and I don't want any limbs to fall on me. So I'm picking an area with an open sky and a thick area that gives me cover and camouflage. And I'm near water, and the creek is actually right down there. Can't quite see it from there, but it's right down there, about 20 yards. And I'm also on a little bit of a hill, so I'll get some shielding from the wind here, because it's actually going to get cold over the next couple of nights. So this looks like this is going to be my spot. So I'm now going to put my tent up. This is about a 10 to 15 minute process. You can do it quicker, but I'll kind of blunder around a little bit. But hey, if I can do it, you can do it too. Notice that I'm moving some sticks out of the way here just to get my ground clear so they don't poke a hole in the tent. But I'm not moving the leaves because the leaves will help act as insulation and cushioning from the ground. Also help keep the bottom of the tarp from getting as wet as it would otherwise. So I'm putting my tarp down, and I'm going to put my tent on top of my tarp. The tarp is going to extend a little bit towards the front of the tent for my vestibule. That's a good place for me to put my boots. You'll see here that as I get the tent up, that it has a open mesh wall and top, which is really good for airflow, and it keeps moisture condensation from getting on you. I am going to use the rain fly. I almost always sleep with a rain fly, and that's just a quirk that I have. I don't like being exposed when I'm sleeping in a tent. I have a concern that if a human was to walk up on me with bad intentions, they would be able to scope out the situation and see where I'm at. And I want to have a little bit of mystery. I don't want somebody to know how many people's in the tent. I don't want them to know which way I'm laying. And if I can hear them walk up, that might give me just enough time to get my gun out and be ready to defend myself. So I don't like sleeping out in the open. I want to be covered. Plus, it's going to get cold tonight and over the next few nights, and so that rain fly will help keep some heat in. Finally, I'm not a big fan of sleeping out on the open ground in snake territory, and this is snake territory. I had a rattlesnake crawl up between my legs once in my life on its own initiative, and that might be a once-in-a-lifetime thing, but the way I see it, you're only going to die once. You know, and a snake's only got to bite you once to die. So I recommend either get off the ground, elevate yourself in a hammock or on some kind of raised platform you might build, or get in a tent so you can close yourself in. Don't just sleep out on the open ground. It might look cool, you know, doing, you know, super survivor man stuff, but it's not safe, not in Florida. So here you can see just how well my tent blends into the surrounding environment. And you want that when you're solo camping. Don't want to draw any attention to yourself. If a human was to walk by me, the chances of them noticing me are pretty slim. So here's what the inside of my tent looks like. I sleep with my bag next to my head, and I sleep to the side. I have my Therm-a-Rest on the right-hand side with my sleeping bag and my sleeping bag liner and my inflatable pillow. And then I keep my firearms within hand's reach to my side. And then I have my loft above me. I'll stow my extra clothes. And then I got my cold weather jacket out there. My next order of business is to get some water and get a fire going. I think I'm going to build a fire right there, so I could sit kind of close to my tent, but yet it'll be far enough away from my tent that it should be safe. And I'm also going to fill up my shower bag of water and probably hang it right above where I'm going to put the fire. So now I'm getting me some water. I'm going to first fill up my water bottle, and then I'm going to bring my shower bag down here and fill it up. And remember, I have to, if you watch my prep video, that shower bag actually has to be fed with a cup. You have to dip water into it. You can't just dunk it under the water, it won't fill up. It's one of the weaknesses of the design. But see here, I'm going to just squeeze the water into my water bottle here from my filter, and this works pretty good. You can hear the constant breeze in the background. Windy conditions are not good for hunting. A lot of game animals, especially squirrel, and to a lesser extent, deer don't like to move when the woods are windy. So I'm not going to try to hunt this evening. I'm going to just focus on getting plenty of water, getting my firewood together, and then I might try to fish in the creek, and I may, you know, just walk around a little bit with the gun. But I'm not going to waste a lot of energy because I know my chances of actually seeing game are slim until the wind dies down. Here I filled up my shower bag. Also got my solar panel set up. See how I can charge my GoPro with it. I had to cut a little hole in my GoPro chases for it, but it works pretty good. Here's a good time to talk about why it's good to have a first aid kit for minor injuries. Of course, you want to be prepared if you have a serious injury, but even minor injuries can be serious enough in the woods that you need to treat them just because you don't want to get an infection, because there's a lot of dirty stuff out in the woods that you're going to be putting open wounds into. I actually pinched my finger pretty bad, or my thumb, I mean, while I was filming off the camera's tripod. So I ended up needing to disinfect and bandage up my thumb. So here you see I got all kinds of little knickknacks in my first aid kit. You know, most of it's just for little minor injuries, just like this. I got my rubbing alcohol that is the fuel for my stove that I'm also going to use as a disinfectant. So I'm getting it out. I'm going to cook set here. I'm going to just squirt it onto my wound. Just like that. And of course it stings, but hey, you know, rather have it sting now than get infected later. So I'm putting it on and rubbing it in. And then I'm going to put a Band-Aid on it. My next step is to collect firewood. What I'm looking for are twigs and limbs that have been held off the ground. We just had some rain, and although things are drying out now, the wood that's sitting on the ground has soaked up a lot of moisture. So I'm picking up limbs that have been sitting in the swamp cabbage for a long time. That's kept them off the ground, kept them in the wind, and kept them pretty dry. So I'm going to collect some big limbs, I'm going to collect some little limbs. You can see the dead cabbage fronds that I'm picking up. I am going to use them as tinder. They make great tinder. You see, I'm going to get some small oak limbs, little tiny ones, to help go in my tinder as well, to help get the fire started. And then once it gets burning real hot, I can start adding the bigger, wetter limbs. I'm also going to use my hatchet not to split the wood, but to cut it into smaller pieces. The only reason I didn't split the wood this time is that I had just put a new handle on my hatchet, and I didn't do a good job of getting it good and secure on there, and I noticed as I was chopping that it was starting to slip, so I decided not to use the hatchet more than what I had to. Now, this wood is too wet to help me start my fire. See, that's old wet, punky wood. This wood, however, is going to be great for helping me get the fire real hot to dry out that wet wood. This is a pine limb right here, and the inside of it is really hard, and it is full of resin. We usually call pieces of dried out pine lighter wood because it lights really easy relative to other kinds of woods, and it burns really hot. So whenever you can find hard, dried out pine wood, that's great for helping you get your fire good and hot. However, while I was chopping, I found some termites. Sounds like lunch. See, they're little things. And I've actually never done this before. I've never tried eating termites. But I'm curious to see what they taste like. They don't seem that bad. See, there's a bunch of them here on the log. I'm not going to cook them. Not going to do anything to them. I'm going to just eat them raw. Eat them alive. Trying to keep my fingers as clean as I can. Get little bits of wood off my fingertips. So I'm just getting bug and not wood. So here goes. What I said was no flavor. They actually have no flavor. It surprised me. They're not gross. They're just kind of flavorless, which is a good thing because I would rather them have no flavor than to taste gross. So I sit here and munch on them, and I just can't believe how they just don't taste like anything. I thought they might taste like wood or taste like just kind of gross squishy bug or something like that, but they don't. So now I'm set up, got my firewood cut, I can relax a little bit. I got my Helinox chair set up, it's very comfortable. You see my firewood here, that's one night's worth of firewood over there. And the wind is still blowing, too strong for me to bother going squirrel hunting, at least to expend a lot of energy doing it. What I'm going to do is go down to the creek, try to see if I can't catch some fish or crawdads down at the creek. I will bring my gun with me in case I happen to see a squirrel. And I'll just keep watching the weather, and as things calm down, I'll get ready to go hunting. But it probably won't be until the morning before I can actually go out and get some fresh game meat. So I went down to the creek, tried to do some fishing, both for crawfish and for brim. No luck there. I did decide to check the side on my 22 because I did give it a really good hit when I unloaded from the vehicle today when my wife dropped me off. And I did, in fact, knock the mount loose that the red dot is attached to. And that has really destroyed my accuracy. That's a problem. And I neglected to bring the right Allen wrenches that I needed to take that side off so I could use the gun's native iron sights that's on the barrel. So I appear to be up the creek without a paddle. Now, thankfully, my multi-tool had a flathead screwdriver on it, and it turned out that I was just able to reach the screw that holds the mount in place, and I was able to tighten it down and get everything zeroed back in like it needed to be. But that's a good lesson that I neither need to come out here with my Allen set or use a different sight that doesn't require it. Now I'm going to get my fire going. What I've done here is I've taken one of these Esbit little tablets that I talk about in my gear video, and I have lit it, and I have put it underneath a whole bunch of dead palm fronds and dried leaves. That'll help it start quick and get hot, and as it gets hot, it'll start to burn twigs I have piled up on there, and then the twigs will start to burn the bigger pieces of wood. But you have to keep feeding it sometimes, because before the bigger pieces catch, sometimes it takes a while for them to get hot enough, so you got to keep feeding it little pieces and keep the fire hotter and hotter and hotter till the bigger pieces catch. Sometimes it could take 20 or 30 minutes of nursing to get a good roaring fire going. I should also point out that making a fire like this is a good way to attract attention to yourself, but understand this is a risk I'm willing to take. A fire is really important to me. It's a comfort item for me, so I'm willing to take that risk. And I'm about to eat my dinner, which is some venison jerky, which is pretty good. I make this myself. This is from deer that I kill, and I make it at home. It's good stuff. Now, after dinner, I decide to have a smoke, and as I'm getting lit up and starting to really enjoy my pipe, I hear some scurrying on a tree behind me. Turns out to be a squirrel right behind me. I keep watching the tree in the center of the picture where it Y's at the top. Watch the squirrel come down into that Y. There he is. And I miss. There goes my dinner. So, I've got jerky, but that's the only thing I've put in my belly in termites. And you can see it's the end of day one, and I'm gonna go to bed in a bit, but y'all stay tuned. I got some real good hunting that's coming up the next morning that I want y'all to see. Thanks for watching.